When I first started making games in Unity and programming in C#, the biggest problem I had was how to communicate between objects. I struggled to wrap my head around how to pass information from one object to another, and when I say object, I mean from one script to another script. To me, passing information around is the most fundamental part of object-oriented programming, and when you truly understand the concept of passing data or information between objects, then you can essentially do anything you want with programming and within Unity. Now, usually to pass information or just communicate with other objects, you need a reference to the object you're trying to speak to. As a side note, in Unity, we tend to have one class per script, so I'm going to use the words class and script somewhat interchangeably. For this video, just think of them as the same thing. So operating within a class, you pretty much have access to everything else in that class, either through direct referencing or passing the information as arguments in a function. But once you start trying to access and communicate with things outside your class, it gets trickier. After all, you can reference the class itself as a type, but this doesn't actually point to anything specific. It's just pointing to a blueprint. Think of it like this. If we have a bunch of balls in a ball pit, referencing the class is like referencing the concept of a ball in our ball pit. Sure, you have the concept of a ball in your script right now, but that's just the concept. It's not actually pointing to any of those specific balls in the pit. So if we want to interact with the balls in our pits, what we need is a way to point to the specific instances, the specific balls from our script. One way to do this is by assigning references within the editor. I've got a scene in Unity with a ball manager class and four balls, each with a ball script on it. If our ball manager script wants to speak to our balls, we could define a field for each ball, serialize it so that the field shows in the editor, and then go and assign each ball to each field. If my script has pre-assigned references to all the objects it needs to speak to, then we can start to communicate between classes. And in many situations, this works fine. But this approach does limit us in a number of ways. First, if you have a lot of game objects, then assigning all of these in the editor can be extremely tedious and also gets pretty messy in the script. But the biggest problem with assigning objects in the editor is that this has to be done before the game runs. If, at runtime, which just means while the game is running, we create a new ball, then our manager won't have a reference to this new object, and so it won't be able to communicate with it. In these scenarios, we have to go with another approach. Suppose we're in the opposite situation. Instead of our manager talking to each ball, we want each ball to be able to communicate with our manager. To do this, we could use static classes. A static class utilizes the static keyword and makes the class globally accessible. This means that any script anywhere within our game can access and communicate with the static class. If I want the balls to be able to communicate with the manager, then I could make my ball manager a static class or create a static instance of it. These are two different things, but in Unity it is generally more common to see static instances because this allows us to instantiate the class and extend from mono behavior, which gives us access to all of the Unity APIs. To make a static instance, we define a static variable of type of ball manager and set it equal to this instance of our class. If you're not familiar with the static keyword, I would do some further research about it because it takes some time to wrap your head around how exactly it works. Anyway, now that we have a static instance of this class, all our balls can access it using the static variable. So now in our ball script, we type the class ball manager, then reference the static variable we just made, and boom, we now have a reference to the ball manager, and we can call any public functions or access any public variables that class defines. Which is all fine and dandy, but we still haven't solved the earlier problem. If we create a new ball at runtime, how can we access it from our ball manager? The new ball will be able to speak to our manager because our manager is a static instance, and so it is globally accessible from any class within our namespace, but our ball manager won't have any idea about this newly created ball. So why don't we make our ball class static so it's globally accessible as well? Doing the same thing, we define a static variable of type ball. As an aside, the name of this variable doesn't have to be instance, it can be whatever you want as long as it's static and is the same type as the class you want to make globally accessible. Now in our manager, we can reference the static instance of the ball and do things to it. For example, let's disable the ball. Doing this, we might expect all of our balls to disappear, but this doesn't actually happen, only one gets disabled. And this is because if you remember, we need to assign an instance to our static variable. And if every ball assigns itself to this same variable, they will overwrite each other. Because we can only ever have one static instance for any given class. which is a pretty big limitation and puts us back to square one about how we can communicate with the balls from our ball manager. Using this static approach only works on objects that have a single instance, so for our many balls, using a static instance is not an option to enable communication between our manager and balls. But all hope is not lost, for this is where events can come in handy. In this case, we can use events to communicate between game objects without having direct references to each other. An event is exactly what it sounds like. We define a certain event, and when that event happens, it gets fired, so to speak. Then, anyone that cares about that event will be notified that the event just occurred and can do something accordingly. In this way, we can indirectly communicate between our ball manager and balls. So in our manager class, we can define a static event of type action. In this example, the event doesn't actually have to be static because we've already made our ball manager class static, so it can be referenced via our static instance of this ball manager class, but I'm making it static regardless. Anyway, don't worry too much about that. Instead, let's focus on the event. There are a few different types of events in C#, but the most common one I use in Unity is the action type. I would encourage you to look at some of the many videos explaining events in more detail, but for most cases, action type events will be sufficient. Then we will name the event. General convention is to begin the name of an event with the word on, followed by a description of the event. So in the case of wanting to disable all our balls, we'll call the event onDisableBalls. Now that we have our event, we can go into our ball script and subscribe to that event. Anyone that is subscribed to an event will be notified when that event occurs. Subscribing to the event doesn't trigger anything, all it does is make sure that this class is listening for when the event does get triggered. The subscription of an event is done when the object is first initialized, so we'll put it in the awake function that is called right when this object is instantiated. This is the syntax used to subscribe to an event in C#. Now, when subscribing to an event, we need to specify what function will be called when the event is actually triggered. So we'll make a function in our class called DisableMe and use this when subscribing. You should also always unsubscribe to the event if and when the object is destroyed, to avoid problems that I won't go into now. So in the onDestroy function, which is funnily enough called when the object is destroyed, we unsubscribe to the event using this syntax. Okay, now we're pretty much done. We have the event defined in our manager class, and we're subscribing to it in our ball class, ready to run the DisableMe function when the event is called. The only thing left to do now is actually trigger the event. We can do this from wherever we want since the event is static, but for this example it makes sense to call the event from the manager script. So we'll create a function called DisableBalls that invokes the event. We use the null conditional operator here given by the question mark and period to avoid null reference errors if no one is subscribed to this event. Then we simply call the invoke function to trigger the event. And that's the event done. If we make this function public, we can hook up the DisableBalls function to a button so we can easily trigger the event when we want. And now we are communicating successfully between our manager script and our ball script. While this might seem like a lot to set up, the reason events are so powerful is because once you've created an event, you can subscribe to it from anywhere you want. So if I wanted another part of my game to also be aware that we've just disabled the balls, we can simply subscribe to the DisableBalls event and do something completely different from there. For example, this game UI. I've subscribed to the DisableBalls event in it, and so now, when the button is clicked, the UI will change. The final reason events are so powerful is because we can use them to pass other information to subscribers in the form of parameters. In our DisableBalls event, we can modify the event signature like so to enable us to pass in an integer when the event is triggered. Let's define an integer field and serialize it so we can modify it in the editor. And now when we invoke the event, we will pass in this number. Then in the ball script, we can define a ball number and modify our DisableMe function that is run on the DisableBalls event to take in an integer. Then we check if the integer received is equal to our ball number, and if it is, we disable ourselves, if not, we just ignore it. Now when we trigger the event, only the ball number we specified is disabled. Again, we can modify our UI to utilize this information and display text accordingly. That is how we use events in Unity to communicate between objects and pass information, enabling us to do essentially anything we want.